There's a old Hebrew word for that. Wow. Amen. Thank you. What a blessing it's been all the way around. Lauren, thank you. Thank you, children. Thank you, youth praise team. Thank you all for participating in the service this morning. And I would like to invite you to take your Bibles this morning and turn to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, one of the most famous verses in all Scripture after maybe John 3:16. But Ephesians chapter 2, and we're going to look at verses 8 through 9. But before we do, I just a couple things I want to observe to you. The first thing is this. The older I get is the more I realize that money cannot buy everything, right? And some things just aren't for sale. Many of you may remember, right down the road in Cyprus, Florida, for many years there was this big old house. You know, it had the porch around it, right there on the west side of the road on Church Street there, right down by the train tracks. It was a beautiful house, and apparently a lot of people were interested in that house because it was the architecture and everything else. So for many years, they had erected this great big sign out by the road. You know what it said? Not for sale. That, I always thought that was strange. I mean, a lot of people put for sale signs out in front of their house, right? They want to get rid of them. But this house was so desirable and so wonderful that the owners had to put not for sale. Well, it's not there anymore. And so I was wondering what happened to it. Apparently, our former representative, if I got my facts straight, Robert Trammell, bought it and had it moved down somewhere by the river down around Bluntstown where he's from. But the fact of the matter is while that house wasn't for sale, eventually it was for sale, right? But there's a lot of things that we face in this world. There's a lot of things that happen in this world. There's a lot of situations that we need to realize that there are things that money cannot buy. Money, good health is not for sale, is it? Oh, you can go to the doctor and you can pay him a lot of money. But good health is not for sale. A good marriage is not for sale. Obedient children are not for sale. Real friendships. I'm talking about the kind where somebody would get on an airplane and fly across the country if you had a child pass away. You know, that kind of stuff. Real friendships are not for sale. There's a lot of things that money cannot buy in this world. A good name is not for sale. And there's one thing that the vast majority of the world thinks is for sale. Did you know that? There's one thing that is not for sale, but the majority of the world thinks is for sale, and that is a relationship with God. You say, preacher, what are you talking about? Where's this coming from, for sale? Well, just hear me, okay? How many religions do you think there are in the world? Wild guess it now. You don't have to be right or wrong. I didn't know it till this week when I was researching it, so I'm the preacher, so don't worry about it, all right? How many religions do you think there are in the world? 40,000 distinct and separate religions in the world. 40,000. Until a while ago, I thought there was maybe 1,000 or 1,500 until I started looking. Boy, was I wrong. 40,000. And in the next two minutes, I'm going to explain to you what 39,999 of them believe. All 40,000 basically have the same goal, and that's to get to something beyond this world, right? Heaven when we die. Something beyond what we are. We all were created to understand that there's something more than just this, right? There's more than just living this life and then dying and then being worm food. There's more than that. And so religions try to seek what is there after this. Well, what is that? All of them have the same goal. But the difference is that 39,999 take one path to get to that goal, and one takes an entirely different approach. And that one is Christianity. And I'm not saying that we're just all goody two shoes and better than anybody else and that what all of that stuff, that's not what I'm saying. But what I do believe is we're right. Right? Because God made us right and God told us what was right and we follow what is right. So what is the difference? Well, 39,999 basically say that the way to get to heaven is to earn it. To do more good than bad, and God will let you into heaven. Mayor Bloomberg of New York City just last week said that very thing. Did y'all read that? He said, I believe I'm going to get into heaven because of the good things that I have done in my life. We need to pray for him, Randy. We do. Because I'm sorry. The Apostle Paul tells us that all of our righteousness, all of it, is like filthy rags in comparison to what it takes to be holy and get to heaven. And it's logical to think that, really, you know, because we're told there's no such thing as a free lunch, right? We're told if you work hard enough, you'll get somewhere in this life. We're told that from the cradle to the grave, right? Work hard, do this, and you'll accomplish things in your life. But it's just completely opposite when it comes to Christianity. Because you will never get to heaven based on what you know. And all 39,999 of them, in some form, some way or another, are trying to angle and work their way to be good enough to have this after this life. But our Bible tells us, and I say this without apology, when it says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, these famous words, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast." I stand up here today on the authority of God's word and tell you that we've got it right. That you can't buy your way into heaven through good works, through accomplishments, through who you are. There is no possible way. And if these words that I just read you from Ephesians chapter 2 are right, then it blows every other religion out of the water. If the Lord was telling us the truth when he inspired the Apostle Paul, then our message truth, and it should be printed on your fill in the blank outline that you got in your worship folder today. The message truth is this. God relates to us through grace, and we relate to him through faith. Now, what is grace? Grace is God's unmerited favor upon us. We didn't do anything to deserve it. God didn't look over heaven and say, "I just can't resist them anymore." It's nothing like that. It is our unmerited favor. And quite frankly, grace is an important concept because in this world that we live in, listen, there can be great distortions about what grace really is. God has a perfect plan for his forgiveness and for our salvation for us, and that is called grace that he offers. But we get it, and sometimes we mix it up. And a mixed up thing of grace in our life is a word called tolerance. To where we elevate someone else's beliefs as if it were our own, and we have to accept them. And I'm not saying respect. I'm not talking about our country where freedom of religion. We Baptists and Christians have stood on the right of individual freedoms of religion. But please don't come to me and tell me that I have to elevate someone else's belief as if it were my own, and it has just as much, should have just as much value in my value system. That's tolerance, and that is a gross misunderstanding of grace that our Lord Jesus Christ has offered us. God relates to us through grace, and we relate to him through faith. So I have a simple two-part sermon this morning. I'll get you to the restaurant before the Methodist. How about that? Amen. First of all, God gives salvation through grace. God gives, and that's a very important word. That's why it's bold and why I left it blank, so you would really get this. God gives salvation through grace. Again, in Ephesians 2, verse 8. "For by grace you have been saved through faith." God gives salvation through grace. There is no more beautiful word in the Bible, no more well-constructed Greek word in the Bible than the word charis, which is the biblical word for grace. Grace is something no one has ever deserved, no one will ever deserve, because there are three ways that God will deal with mankind. Three ways. There's justice, mercy, and grace. Justice, mercy, and grace are the three ways God will deal with mankind. That is so hard for many to get a hold of because it doesn't seem rational. It doesn't seem like it makes good horse sense. It's like Adrian Rogers used to say, horse sense is what keeps horses from betting on people, right? You have to earn a Super Bowl ring if you're in the NFL. You have to earn a PhD if you're going to postgraduate school. You have to earn that retirement that you've gotten through the years. You earn what you get in this life is what rational things tell us. But that's why many don't like Jesus at all, because he ruined their system. The Pharisees are a prime example in the New Testament. Over and over, they were trying to work. They were trying to earn their salvation. They were trying to do all the right things, dot all the I's, cross all the T's. And in the end, it was futileness, and Jesus called them a bunch of vipers because they lorded over trying to be better than anyone else and try to earn their way into life. So there's one back in the 39,999, right? Phariseeism. Trying to earn your way into God's favor. You can't earn, look at me, you can't earn what's already been paid for. You can't. It's impossible. Think about it. How odd it would be. You go to work tomorrow and your boss comes in and says, if you work today, I'm not going to pay you, but if you do nothing, I will. That doesn't make any sense. It's irrational, right? But here's what many people, even some maybe in this room today, totally, really believe. If I said Jesus died on the cross for your salvation, you would say, yes, he did. I believe that we would get in a pretty total agreement here at First Baptist Church Sneeds this morning. Christ died on a cross for our salvation. But what you really believe in your heart, if you really dig down deep, is what you really believe is that he made the down payment, and you have to make installments through good works and church attendance and baptism. Yes, it couldn't have been done without him dying on the cross, but I've got to do this, this, and this, and this to be right with God. And you're very quickly seeping over and sliding over into the 39,999 rather than the one. It says, for by grace you are saved through faith. Here's the problem with that. God is not a salesman, okay? He is not trying to sell you a life insurance policy. He's not a salesman. Salvation is not a bargain God makes with you. It's an offer he gives to you. And that's a blessing, friends, when you really, that you're not making some kind of bargain with God. He is giving you this offer. It's not a reward for those who do enough. It's a gift for those who accept it. God gives salvation through grace. But the second part is as simple as that one. We get salvation through faith. We get salvation through faith. Most people, some of you, look at life as a gigantic ledger book. Like somewhere God's got this big old debit and credit book, and he holds it up in heaven and check that off. Yeah, he went to church. Oh, he went to Sunday school today. Man, that's good. That's good. Stroke his big old long beard people think he has, you know. And, oh, what? That's bad. He was mean to his kids or was mean to his wife. And they see God up in heaven as keeping some kind of ledger book about our good and our bad. Like he's some kind of cosmic accountant and deciding if you have a net profit at the end of your life. The fact is we're all bankrupt without him. There's no need of any kind of ledger book. It would have been thrown out long, long ago. And there are some of you that need to do business with God for the first time today. Right away, and throw out this old ledger book and get a hold of the Lamb's Book of Life and get your name written in it. Where it's all straight and it's all settled. The problem is that far too long, you have been bringing the wrong things to the table. Lord, here's my church attendance. Nothing wrong with church attendance. I'm all for it, okay? Lord, here's my baptismal certificate. Nothing wrong with it. I'm all for baptism. It's a great, beautiful picture of that. But you can't bring that to God saying, now you can accept me, Lord. Good works. You say, God will accept. Will you accept me if I do enough? And God wants only one thing from you. Look at me.
God wants only one thing from you, and that is to have faith in Him. Because without faith, the Bible says it is impossible to please God. Impossible. You can do all the good works, you're going to fail. Jump through all the hoops, you're going to fail. But if you have faith, you please God.
Faith is not believing in something, it's believing on someone, and there's a huge difference. Faith is not, you can believe in that pew, and it may, after a while, rot or get old, and it may break down, and you may fall when you sit down. You can believe in that pew, but real faith is believing on someone. I tried to think of a way to illustrate this as best I could, and I was thinking, I have a first cousin who's more like a brother to me. We were about the same age. We were raised up together, and he's kind of a cautious type, you know, in a lot of things in his life. Very tight with his money, you know, all of that stuff. But good guy. Good guy. So one day I convinced him that I was going to take him flying in my airplane. It was shocking when he agreed to go with me. I'll be honest with you, because he's a careful guy. He's got one son, you know. They've tried to have more children and can't. So he finally agreed to it. Before he went, though, he wrote a letter to his son, you know, making sure he told him everything that he wanted him to know. But you know what? My cousin Tim could have stood right there at Marion Airport, and he could have looked at that plane I flew in on. And he could have looked at the wheels and looked at the wings, and he's a mechanic, so he knows how everything works. He could have looked at it. He could have looked at me and said, "I believe that you know how to fly." The FAA gave you a pilot's license. I believe it. But until he got in there and got strapped into that airplane and I pushed the power like a crazy man, you got to be a little crazy to push the power forward on an airplane, I'll be honest, and take flight. That's what birds do. Anyway, I pushed the power and we took off. Until all of that happened, he really didn't believe I could fly that airplane. Do you understand the difference in saying you believe something and going all in on something? And that's the same thing with us and the Lord. We can't go halfway. We can't say, "Lord, I believe you could save me. Lord, I believe that you died on the cross and you rose again. I believe it," unless we commit and we say, "You know what, we're going to either crash or we're going to fly with you, Lord," and I guarantee you'll always fly. Always. You'll soar like the eagles. According to Isaiah, it says, "They who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and shall not faint." Praise God. He'll take you flying one day. That's the dividing line between the 39,999 and the one. Galatians chapter 2, verse 16 says, "Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Christ Jesus, that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the," next slide please, "by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified." The Lord has told us, and that verse is a litmus test, friends. No other way around it. You're either going to work your way to heaven, or you're going to have faith in the Lord to get to heaven. That's just all there is to it. Six times we are told that salvation is through faith by grace. It has nothing to do with your works, has nothing to do with your religion, has nothing to do with anything else other than faith and the grace of the Lord. And if you do not believe that, then you do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's as simple as that. Y'all all right? Years ago, and if I said the man's name, most everybody in here would know who I'm talking about. He's dead and gone now. But years ago, I went to witness to a man. The whole purpose was to tell him about Jesus Christ and lead him to faith in Jesus Christ. And when I got to his back porch, he was sitting on the back porch, and I went up and began talking with him. And he had a beer in his hand, a bottle of beer in his hand, drinking it. It was after work, you know, and I guess he was enjoying him a beer. And I walked up and sat down. He invited me to sit down. He said, "You think this beer is going to send me to hell, don't you?" I said, "No, sir, I do not. I don't think anything will send you to hell except not believing in Christ Jesus." That's the only thing that's going to send you to hell. And it opened up the door to begin a conversation. Now, he didn't offer me a beer, you know, thank the Lord, because I'd have had to hurt his feelings. But we talked, and he began to understand. But it just wasn't quite there. And he never would quite grab hold by faith. He was hung up on this work stuff, doing enough good stuff. And he did a lot of good things. Stuff named after him. He did a lot of things. A lot of noble, charitable things. But unless that attitude in his heart changed from that day on that porch, he's in hell. And that breaks my heart. And it breaks the Lord's heart. I pray that somewhere along the way he considered that and reconsidered that and gave his life to the Lord. He very well may could have, you know. But the fact of the matter is
the Lord is specific. Any good that you do will not get you into heaven. And any bad that you do won't keep you out of heaven. Do you understand that?
You say, well, preacher, that sounds like a blank check. It sounds like I can do whatever I want and it doesn't really matter.
I would say like Lee Corso, not so fast, my friend. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10 says this, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." So what am I saying? Good works is not what you do to earn your salvation. They are what you do because of your salvation. And they are evidence, friends. They are not a price for salvation. They are a proof of salvation. And if you're not doing good works, and if you're not serving the Lord, then you really need to revisit whether you've ever accepted his grace through faith. Amen? You believe that? Heard about a man who was on trial for murder, and his lawyer said, you know, this man had a lot of money. He said, you're out of here. You're gonna go to the electric chair. They got you. So they worked out this deal where they approached one of this elderly jurors and offered him a $50,000 bribe to hold out for manslaughter so he could preserve his life. That's the only hope they thought they had. So the man took it. They went to trial, you know, and did the whole thing, and the jury was out for days and days and days. Finally, they came back after 6 days. It was a hung jury. They could not come to a decision. So the trial was dismissed. Afterwards, he stole a moment with that jury. He said, "Thank you, man. Thank you, man, for helping me. The money was well spent." He said, "Man, you know, I held out for manslaughter as long as I could, but I was the only one, you know, that everybody else wanted to acquit you." So many people try to bribe God with religion or good works. And my original premise from the very beginning is this, friends. There's some things that are not for sale. There's some things money can't buy. God has already voted for your acquittal. All you have to do is stand up and accept it. Amen? Amen. Let's stand quietly as we pray together. Lord Jesus, we ask you in this time, we ask you in this day, that if there's anyone here who's trying to get right with you through good works, Lord, that they would give up the fight, Lord, and understand that you are not for sale. Lord, you're for free. Lord, I pray that we would just see several folks just come and to bow their lives before you and accept your free gift of grace through faith. Let them believe on you. In your sweet and precious and holy name, I pray. Amen.